What is 0 to 1? 0 to 1 is to create something new from scratch, instead of copying others and improve incrementally. This is about business, but it's even more about being creative as an entrepreneur. In the book 0 to 1 that Peter Thiel finished back in 2014, he made some very interesting points. So in today's video, I would like to share some notes and annotations I took and see where they will bring us. There are already tons of materials out there giving a good basic outline for the book. In this video, my goal is to focus only on Peter's labeling of four viewpoints to see the future and give a more detailed review based on them. Potentially, this might be of use for others in the future. There are lots of fancy controversial points given by the author throughout this work, like capitalism and competition are opposites. Capitalism is premised on the accumulation of capital, but under perfect competition, all profits get competed away. In other words, we should avoid competition instead of chasing them. So the system around us has long been training us to get used to it. It is up to us to rethink over it. Peter also gave us the idea that competition is not just an economic concept or a simple inconvenience that individuals and companies must deal with in the marketplace. More than anything else, competition is an ideology, the ideology that pervades our society and distorts our thinking. We preach competition, internalize its necessity, and enact its commandments. And as a result, we trap ourselves within it. Even though the more we compete, the less we gain. Consider the opening line from Romeo and Juliet. Two households, both alike in dignity. The two houses are alike, yet they hate each other. They grow even more similar as the feud escalates. Eventually, they lose sight of why they started fighting in the first place. It's true, winning is better than losing, but everybody loses when the war isn't one worth fighting. Since recently I have been studying Homer and the Trojan War, the quote seems even more powerful for me than I first read it. Besides the author's redefinition of competition, he also talks about problems with our education system, how to find the right people to found a company with, and the right people to hire as a startup, as well as various other creativity-related topics helping one to find success as entrepreneurs. From the Renaissance and the Enlightenment to the mid-20th century, luck was something to be mastered, dominated, and controlled. Everyone agreed that you should do what you could, not focus on what you couldn't. Ralph Waldo Emerson captured this ethos when he wrote, "Shallow men believe in luck, believe in circumstances. Strong men believe in cause and effect." No matter you believe in luck or not, whether or not you think that one might control the future, Peter divided views of the future into four groups: indefinite pessimism, definite pessimism, definite optimism, and indefinite optimism. So what are these terms standing for? Indefinite pessimists believe in a bleak future, and they have no idea what to do about it. This happens to be a precise description for Europe since early 1970s, when their continent succumbed to the indirect bureaucratic drift. In this context, Europeans just react to events as they happen and hope things don't get worse. In another word, people like this take a quite passive approach towards the ever-changing environments. The second is definite pessimism. China is the most definitely pessimistic place in the world. Every other country is afraid that China is going to take over the world. China is the only country afraid that it won't. China relentlessly copies what has already worked in the Western and knows exactly the outcome. The Chinese know that winter is coming. Every class of people here takes future deadly seriously. The third category is definite optimism. I think it will be easier to understand as the so-called American dream. From the 17th century through the 1950s and the 1960s, definite optimists led the Western world. People used to dream a lot, making big projects and taking seemingly impossible blueprints seriously. Peter gave tons of examples to prove how people, especially those in America, used to have various bold plans throughout all different kinds of industries. In late 1940s, a Californian citizen called John Rabel set out to reinvent the physical geography of the whole San Francisco Bay Area. The media and the professionals took it for real and made tests and simulations for that. Note that he was just an actor, theatrical producer, and school teacher. But today there probably won't be many take visions like this seriously anymore. Since 1982, the indefinite optimism took over America. To an indefinite optimist, the future will be better, but one doesn't know how exactly. So one won't make any specific plans. He expects to profit from the future, but sees no reason to design it concretely. These are the categorization for this topic Peter gave in his book, 0-1. But is that this simple? Not too long ago, I read another book called The Sense of Style by Steven Pinker, a renowned cognitive psychologist, linguistic, and popular science author born in 1954. In the end of that book, he warned the readers, "Beware of false dichotomies. Though it's fun to reduce a complex issue to a war between two slogans, two camps, and two schools of thought, it is rarely a path to understanding. Few good ideas can be insightfully captured in a single word ending with ism. And most of our ideas are so crude that we can make more progress by analyzing and redefining them than by pitting them against each other in a winner-take-all contest. Finally, arguments should be based on reasons, not people. Saying that someone you disagree with is motivated by money, fame, politics, or laziness, or slinging around insults like simplistic, naive, or vulgar, does not prove that the things the person is saying are false, nor is the point of disagreement or criticism to show that you are smarter or nobler than your target. Psychologists have shown that in any dispute, both sides are convinced that they themselves are reasonable and upright, and that their opposite numbers are mollish and dishonest. They can't all be right, at least not all the time. Keep in mind a bit of wisdom from the linguistic unfarmer. It isn't about being right, it's about getting it right. I admit there have been some very interesting thoughts from 0-1. I also have faith that Peter, as a co-founder of PayPal and one of the most successful American entrepreneurs and venture capitalists, did give us many good suggestions and insights. However, it's worth a second thought as an independent individual to consider the purpose behind themes and ask ourselves such a question. What is he selling? Like Peter wrote in the chapter, "If you build it, will they come?" Poor sales rather than bad product is the most common cause of failure. From another perspective, good sales do not indicate that the product is good either. Start to notice our own choice of words in each language. Be extra careful while using words like good or bad, right or wrong, as well as beautiful or ugly, in all contexts. Over time, it will prove itself quite rewarding and automatically make one who keeps this as a habit more of a critical thinker.